the European Union as a political edifice is the pressing refugee and migration flows, especially from the Turkish coast to the Greek islands and from there to the other countries of the EU. This is a big problem of multiple dimensions and ramifications, overt and latent ones, that are worth to be put on record, and will begin with the international political dimension of this phenomenon. The refugee crisis that is testing the institutional, political and social limits of the European Union was neither sudden nor unexpected. The civil war in Syria has been going on for years. The formation of the so-called Islamic State and its attempt to put under its control a quasi territory that extends mainly on the territory of Syria and Iraq, reaching Libya, is also an old story. The non-European shore of the Mediterranean, the Middle East and North Africa are geographically very close to the European Union. Turkey, a country which borders with Syria and Iraq, is also a candidate for EU accession, for EU membership for many years. The distance that separates the coast of Turkey from Greek islands are in many cases less than 3 nautical miles. The international political dimension of the refugee crisis was apparent and known. The situation in Syria and Libya are the result of the frivolous approach on part of the West of the phenomenon of the so-called Arab Spring. The EU, as a global political and military entity, has not been able to play a key role in managing the crisis in Syria, the reopening of the war in Iraq, the revolving crisis in Libya. Entire state entities like Syria and Libya are subject to dissolution. Their statehood is being disputed, while international terrorist organizations like ISIS are transforming, claiming statehood, territory, population, and first of all, primary power. The EU is suffering from the effects of the terrorist threat and the asymmetric war, is very close geographically to the crisis spots, is an alarming destination for refugees and irregular migrants, but it is a weak international player. The EU's role in the agreement with Iran was important, but it was a complementary one to the role of the US, Russia, and the Permanent Security Council member of the European Union, like UK and France, plus Germany, because, as you know, the scheme was the five permanent members of the Security Council and Germany. The same applies in regards to Syria. After the failure of Geneva I and the impossibility of the practical completion of Geneva II, after the military operation of Russia that altered the military balances on the field, with the departure of ISIS from Palmyra, it has been made apparent how limited the ability for intervention on part of the EU is, especially so when there are direct contacts, officially or unofficially, between the US and Russia. The international political dimension of the refugee issue obviously stems from the deeper geopolitical, energy, ethnic, and religious causes of the crisis in Syria, of the crisis once again in Iraq, in Libya, and so on. But the EU is associated with this only as a result, because it is called upon to manage the refugee issue as a symptom of the war. However, the refugee crisis, like the military conflicts that cause it, is not a European issue, but an international one. It's an issue that falls under the competence of the UN, not just its humanitarian side that falls under the jurisdiction of the High Commissioner for Refugees, but the competence concerning international security itself that is under the jurisdiction of the Security Council. The international community, though, is not mobilized at this level. It deems that the humanitarian dimension, which is very important but secondary, is sufficient. The same applies to the non-European countries of the wide region. Stability in Egypt, for example, is crucial in order for a solution to the Syrian problem to exist. the need to avoid the diffusion of the impact of the situation in Syria in the Middle East issue, in the relations between Israel and Palestine, especially in Gaza, is also obvious. However, the Arab states that possess financial strength do not contribute as much as they should to addressing the refugee crisis. The 4 million of Syrian refugees and the many more millions of internally displaced persons is a heavy international political reality. The countries hosting Syrian refugees, Turkey, Jordan, Lebanon, have a heavy burden to bear. From all these, though, Turkey is the one that de facto controls the flows to the EU via the Greek islands. The pressure on Turkey's border with Syria and Iraq, the importance of the Kurdish issue in the internal and foreign policy of Turkey, the connection of these issues with ethnic and religious minorities within Turkey makes Turkey a de facto key interlocutor with EU and not just a candidate country like others. Turkey, however, plays an active role in shaping the situation in Syria. It's not simply subjected to the refugee pressures as a neighboring country. It has been attempting for years, since the beginning of the crisis and the civil war, to affect the political and military balance in Syria. On the other hand, the route from Turkey to the Greek islands brings to the fore the greed of Greek-Turkish relations in the Aegean Sea and the Eastern Mediterranean Sea. The unilateral, according to the Greek official position always, the unilateral Turkish demands, issues of sovereignty, sovereign rights, and international responsibilities, issues of territorial waters, airspace, FIR, flight information region, search and rescue, infringement of the air traffic rules, and violation of airspace, overflights, the militarization, according to Turkish allegation, of the Dodecanese Islands and islands of the northeastern Aegean, such as Limnos. All these are linked with the rules and practices of the mission and exercises of NATO, of exercises, not during a real war operation, which was asked to oversee the Greek-Turkish sea borders as the European borders with Turkey, when the idea of joint Greek-Turkish patrols was rejected. In the background, there is always the Cyprus issue. At the time of intercommunal negotiations, with Turkey requesting the opening of new chapters in the negotiation procedure with the EU, while many crucial chapters cannot be opened because of Turkey's attitude and responsibility in the Cyprus issue. This is the first dimension, the first approach, the international political one. The second one is the refugee issue as a matter of internal security for the European Union. The European attitude towards the refugee issue is thus formed with international political criteria, external security criteria, but also with very intense internal security criteria. The situation in Syria, Iraq, Libya, the developments in the operation against ISIS, the rule of Kurdish forces, the internal situation in Turkey, etc., are directly linked with acute internal security issues for the EU and its member states. This is not an internal European terrorist threat, but an explosive combination of internal cooperation of a significant number of people residing in EU member states and external attacks against EU member states as part of an asymmetric war with religious, anti-Western and anti-European ideological rhetoric. After the events in Paris and those in Brussels a few weeks ago, the dimension of internal security is extremely crucial since it refers to the core of the concept of the state and sovereignty, which has the monopoly of legitimate violence and the responsibility to protect the internal and external security of the citizens. There is the terrorist threat, the disruption of internal security, the change in the attitude of European society towards refugees and irregular migrants. Phenomena of violence against women intensify these reactions. There are now new forms of xenophobic discourse. Xenophobic and simultaneously Eurosceptic parties are established or see their political influence increasing in many member states, with the prime example being Germany after the last local elections. The traditional liberalism, according to the European concept of liberalism and tolerance in Europe, is receding even more in the Nordic countries, much more in Austria, Hungary, Slovakia, Poland, the other so-called Visegrad countries. Europe, therefore, initially opened and then closed its borders to refugees from Syria, Iraq, and certain areas of Afghanistan. The other dimension is the demographic one, very important. The initially open German attitude was largely due to demographic reasons, the need to strengthen and renew the German population, the labor market, and the German social insurance funds. This obviously has a limit around the 1 million people that have already been accepted. The last regional elections in Germany, the questioning of the policy of Chancellor Merkel, as it was expressed in the polls, and the rise of the Eurosceptic Party led to a change of policy. Practically, the final stance of Germany coincides with that of Austria and the so-called Visegrad countries. The next dimension is the refugee issue as a test of the EU's institutional structure and the European integration. The management of refugee flows as a crisis management has brought back to the surface of major question of the nature and adequacy of the EU's institutional structure and its relations with the member states. When internal and external security issues, national identity issues, social reaction that cause challenging the legitimacy of political institutions arise, there is questioning of sovereignty of member states. Then everyone remembers that EU competences are all conferred by member states to the Union as institutional entities, that the major European decisions are intergovernmental, not communal. The question is posed, who manages the crisis successfully, the EU or its member states individually? The answer is of course obvious for the European point of view. The EU, this is the initial raison d'etre. However, tensions blunt. And when we refer to the EU, we do not refer to bodies that operate using the so-called community decision-making process, but to the European Council, the summit, as a body with strong intergovernmental characteristics. Also, the 28 member states had to agree among themselves and with Turkey. And this agreement causes many objections by the UN High Commissioner for Refugees and international non-governmental organizations concerning respecting the Geneva Convention for the Protection of Refugees and especially the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg. The more specific European institutional architecture of the Schengen Treaty and the Dublin III regulation was deemed as not being enough to manage such large flows. The Commission's proposal, the European Commission's proposals, to create a European border and coast guard for the control of the so-called smart borders, for the distribution of refugees in member states, cannot give quick and easy results. The humanitarian crisis of the previous years on the other sides of the Mediterranean coast, the side of Egypt, Libya, Tunisia, with flows toward Italy and the famous and tragic island of Lampedusa, did not sufficiently mobilize the European Union or the international community. The EU keeps running behind events. This is the historical and political problem, the existential problem of the European Union on global level, not only on the regional one. Moreover, the refugee crisis, with the open question of Calais, because Calais is emblematic place, more emblematic than Idomeni, who is now very famous, with the open question of Calais, as its emblem affects the attitude of British society in relation to the Brexit, and the expected referendum will affect the overall perspective of the European integration even more strongly than the economic crisis that erupted in 2008-2009 within the Eurozone. We have also a fifth, more regional dimension, the relationships between Greece and Turkey. Economic crisis era Greece, therefore, is for geographical reasons the focus of a refugee and migration crisis that has not only got European, but also, as I said, international dimensions. The refugee issues is for Greece a major issue of internal and external security. It entails additional financial burden. It tests the limits of local communities, especially on border islands, whose economy is mainly based on tourism. The great increase of flows from about 72,000 people in 2014 to approximately 1 million in 2015 has put to the test the practical ability of Greece to fully implement the Schengen Treaty and the Dublin Regulation, which is any account unjust for the first European host country, which geographically is Greece by necessity. It's true that in 2015, hundreds of thousands of refugees and irregular migrants crossed from Turkey to the Greek islands, moved inland, and from there via the so-called Balkan corridor, traveled to Germany or other European countries of their preference, without full checks and identifications being performed in Greece, with the tolerance and the collaboration of the EU and other member states, of course. In March 2016, the situation changed, primarily because the German stance also changed, for the reason we have seen. The European Council decision and the EU-Turkey agreement accept the closure of the northern border between Greece and the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. The Balkan corridor has been shut, as demanded by Austria and the Visegrad countries. About 55,000 people, refugees and migrants, adult men, women, children, elderly, disabled people with different national, ethnic and religious identity are trapped in the Greek mainland without being able to go to the other European countries and with no immediate prospect of readmission to Turkey, without no provision and possibility for quick review of any application for asylum, secondary protection or humanitarian protection status. Around 15,000 people live under terrible conditions in Idomeni, a makeshift camp that is recognized nor supported by the Greek state, which proposed the transfer to organized settlers to stay for an unknown period of time with indefinite perspective. This is the problem. In the decades of 1990 and 2000, Greece accepted and absorbed hundreds of thousands of migrants for Albania, Pakistan, other countries who wanted to stay in Greece, in a prosperous European country before the crisis, to work, to build a new life. The 55,000 who are now trapped here do not want to stay in Greece, but to leave soon. They feel unlucky. They feel like prisoners, and the difference is crucial. Now, however, the EU-Turkey agreement applies for newcomers from the Turkish coast to Greek islands. Those who submit asylum applications have to wait for a definitive answer within 14 days. This is practically impossible. Those eligible for asylum status obviously remain in Greece. I speak on a legal, theoretical level, as required by the Geneva Convention and with the capacities defined by Dublin regulations. Those who do not submit an application or whose application is rejected normally return to Turkey under the supervision of European and Turkish officials in the Greek islands. For each Syrian returning to Turkey, Turkey sends to the EU another Syrian who did not attempt to enter illegally into the European Union and who is a refugee according to the description of the Geneva Convention. The EU supports Greece administratively and financially through the Frontex primarily, and the EU supports Turkey, offering it large sums to keep Syrian refugees in its territory. The EU considers Turkey as a safe country, according to the definition of the Geneva Convention, and essentially, this is the practical result of this agreement, as the first European country where asylum applications can be made according to the Dublin Regulation, not explicitly, but this is finally and de facto the new interpretation of the Dublin Regulation. This is the new element. The integration of Turkey in the European Union, especially for this purpose, for the implementation of the Dublin Regulations. From this point of view, now Turkey is the entry point of the European Union, and this is something very important because we have the obligation to declare as a safe country Turkey. This is very important not only for the refugee crisis but also for other very fragile and very delicate aspects of our bilateral relationships. Turkey is obliged to impose, on the other hand, visas for citizens from safe countries, such as Morocco, who go to Turkey in order to illegally enter to Greece and after to the European Union. Turkey has undertaken to fulfill many conditions for the visa waiver for Turkish citizens traveling to the EU by the end of June. This is the critical period, from now until the end of June, because the visa waiver for the Turkish citizen is the main pillar of this agreement between EU and Turkey. And in case of a new crisis, in case of a reopening of the negotiation between Turkey and the European Union, the main victim will be Greece, as the first real European country of reception. Turkey has now the obligation to fulfill 72 conditions in order to achieve this emblematic target of visa waiver from the European for the European Union for Turkish citizens, but this is something very difficult to be accomplished. Meanwhile, the chapter of the accession negotiations between EU and Turkey that are linked with Cyprus have not opened, since Turkey does not fulfill its obligations to recognize the Republic of Cyprus and allow the docking of Cypriot ships and aircraft in Turkish ports and airports. This is the famous problem of the Protocol of Ankara. The effort of the Greek government to link the refugee issue with the famous review of the third Greek bailout program and any intervention to the Greek public debt was rather unfortunate. The review did not appear to be affected, and there has been no relaxation on the claims for new measures. The intervention to the debt is agreed and expected since 2012. As far as the refugee issue is concerned, what happens in Greece depends on the state of implementation of the EU-Turkey agreement and on Turkey's stance. We have already commented on what the presence of NATO in the Greek-Turkish sea border means. As you understand, and this is my final remark, the refugee crisis is a crisis under evolution. It's not just a humanitarian international crisis, but a very complex problem with many very delicate dimensions, and from this point of view, we have the obligation to take into consideration not only the refugee crisis itself, but also the wider environment, especially for Greece, because actually we are before a double crisis, the economic and financial one, and a big, unique, historically speaking, crisis of internal and external security and safety in our region. From this point of view, the refugee crisis is a laboratory for us, because we have the possibility to examine simultaneously economic, financial, fiscal, international, and local problems, in order to take some lessons. But during a crisis in evolution, it's very difficult to make and to present the predictions, because every day we have new elements, new dimensions, and very often we have dramatic changes in the political behavior of the big players of this very difficult and very dangerous game. Thank you very much for your attention.